So I was wondering if you could get us a bit caught up. So there's readers who are just starting the All Souls Trilogy. A Discovery of Witches has been out for about a year now, is that about
Since
right?
February 2011, so 16
more.
Months maybe.
Yeah. So could you give us kind of a snapshot of that book and where we left readers, without giving away too much for the readers who may not have read it?
So Discovery of Witches is about a reluctant witch named Diana Bishop, who's a historian, and who is the last of a long line of distinguished witches that can be traced all the way back to Salem, Massachusetts in the 1690s. And like many young people, she's being encouraged to go into the family business, which is not accounting or hardware stores, but actually magic, and she doesn't want to do it. So she's made what she thinks is a really careful, logical decision to be a historian, which she sees as being very rational, and she's interested in the history of science, which she sees as sort of the triumph of rationality over magic. And that very neat, orderly world all starts to disintegrate one autumn night when she finds a manuscript at Oxford's Bodleian Library that turns out to have been missing for a very long time and may very well have been deliberately hidden using magical spells and powers. Even though she sort of dismisses the finding and sends it back and thinks everything will go back to normal, nothing will ever be normal again. And one of the reasons for that is because a whole host of other creatures sort of come out to ask her about her discovery, including a 1,500-year-old scientist and vampire named Matthew Claremont. So Discovery of Witches really follows their deepening relationship and their search for this Ashmole manuscript that so many people have looked for but was thought missing. And at the end, they've gotten themselves into a fair amount of trouble, and they have to make a pretty surprising escape plan that involves not the question of where shall we hide, but when shall we hide.
So we have a cliffhanger at the end of the first book.
We do.
Okay, and then it takes us into the second book. So the first book is based in contemporary times.
It is.
So Diana is a contemporary researcher, mm-hmm. she's an academic, mm-hmm. and she meets this 1,500-year-old vampire.
Right, walking history, which for a historian would be pretty irresistible.
But she wants to discover the truth about things. Can you talk a little bit about like how she sort of, she sort of turns her back on witchcraft, as you mentioned earlier, the family mm-hmm, profession. Mm-hmm. How does Matthew bring her back into the world of magic?
Well, I think for Diana, as a historian, she's come up with what she finds is a satisfying story about, you know, how the truth can be located by reason and experiment and, you know, by using intellectual powers, not magical ones. And Matthew sort of keeps throwing it up examples and instances that he remembers where, you know, science never really made the magic go away, and that science and magic are really part of the same kind of tangled knot that all has to do with questions about who am I, why am I here, what is my relationship to something bigger than myself. And so for Matthew, who is a man of very deep faith as well as a scientist, he doesn't make the kind of hard and fast divisions between science and magic that Diana really has made in order to, again, sort of keep everything in nice, neat, orderly boxes so that she doesn't have to worry about it.
And he sort of breaks down all of those walls, all of those boxes.
Right, he really does. And because she's a historian, I mean, he speaks with the authority of history behind him. Mm-hmm. So it presents, I think, some interesting dilemmas for a historian who, you know, has a historical source who says, you know, this didn't work for Newton. Isaac Newton couldn't separate magic and science, or why would it work for you? So it would be pretty hard for her to come up with a snappy response to that.
Mm-hmm. And he's a geneticist also.
He is.
He knows history, he's lived history, but he's also a man of science, a man of faith. He's sort of a Renaissance man in a way.
He is, although he was 1,000 sort of when the Renaissance really came into being. He is a Renaissance man, but he is somebody who has lived a very long time, who's accumulated a lot of baggage along the way and ideas about how things should work and what his place is in the world, and was born in a really different time where people's values and their relationships with people were very different than they are in the modern era. So that's another hurdle that he and Diana have to really address.
So in the second book, in Shadow of Night, they're leaving the contemporary moment, mm-hmm. and they're going back in time. Can you tell us about the world of Elizabethan England that they go to, and how that's how you explored that world, how you developed that world for your readers?
Elizabethan England is probably the time period I know best. In some ways, bizarrely, I probably know it better than my own time period, in the sense that it's where I spend most of my time intellectually, because I'm a historian of 16th century, specifically England. I've been teaching the period to students since I graduated from graduate school, which is 1994, so for a number of years, and I'm always struck at the ways in which students think that the past would be similar to now, how it would be different from now. I'm struck by the things that they think they know and the things that they're surprised by. And I think all of that sort of contributed to my sense that it would be really fun to put a vampire sort of 1,000 years into, have to send a vampire back to an earlier point in his life and to send a contemporary person back with them, one who is a historian, who maybe feels like she has the answers and knows what the past was like, a vampire who thinks he knows what the past was like because he lived it, mm-hmm. and to have everything not go according to those, again, nice, neat plans.
Mm-hmm. Because Diana's she's so confident and so sure of herself in so many things, in particular in her scholarship. Mm-hmm. And Matthew's very impressed with her scholarship, mm-hmm. and is really amazed that she can actually get it right, that mm-hmm. she didn't live in those times, but yet she can communicate that world to contemporary readers mm-hmm. In her scholarship. So they're an interesting duo in the sense of time travel to go back to that world.
And for both of them, they've only known each other. When the first book ends, they've only known each other for 40 days. So they're still in that sort. They've made an awful lot of promises and commitments to each other, as we often do when we fall in love and we're caught up in that rush of, pheromones and attraction, and everything about the person is sort of fabulous, and you pretend you like baseball even if you don't, or whatever, in order to kind of get along. And the two of them are very sharp, they're very strong intellectually, they're very strong individually, and they've got to figure out, again, sort of now what they're going to do now that they've so boldly stepped off and thinking this was going to just be
And what's the purpose of their trip back in time to Elizabethan England? It has to do with the manuscript, Ashmole.
It has to do with the manuscript, and it has to do with the sort of mysteries surrounding what on earth is this power that Diana has. People can't really understand it. It doesn't conform to the kind of patterns that people expect. She's different. And that difference has always made Diana has added to her reluctance to kind of live up to the family reputation of being, a strong witch. She's got a lot of those in the family tree. So for her, it's also a chance to maybe find someone who might have the answers to the questions of who is Diana Bishop? What is she? Why is she there? What kind of power does she have? And by going back to the 16th century, again, to that sort of period where science and magic lived a little bit more side by side, I think they both hope that they might find someone who might have answers for them about what Diana is.
That's so interesting that she's a historian, but yet she really has to focus on her own personal history. Mm-hmm. And she's sort of been in denial about her own legacy all of those years. Are there any little hints you can give to us about some of the things that happened to them along the way without any spoilers?
Well, I think there's a couple of things that probably people can relate to pretty quickly and say, oh, yes, of course. One of which is that moment when you've basically been a little bubble of you and this person you're falling in love with, and then it's time to meet the family and the friends. And you're sort of, thrust into this world, and here's all these people you haven't met. You're trying to sort out the personalities and what the power dynamics. You don't know anyone. You're kind of on trial. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the position Diana's going to be in.
Whether you're a witch and vampire or just normal,
or just a
mere mortals.
Mortal couple, human couple, that's right. And the other thing is that, they're... they go back and they join up with a world that's sort of in, you know, living life. It's in midstream, and they're just going to be plunked down like a feather in a moving brook and be carried away with what's happening then at the time. So they're going to have to really kind of work to catch up and get acclimatized in a way that's efficient, in a way that doesn't flag too many of their adjustment problems. So it's really stressful to sort of be put in that. Yeah, well, and just if you've ever been away sort of on vacation, if you've done study abroad, if you've gone away to college and then you return home and, you know, plants have grown and people have gotten older and babies who couldn't walk can now walk and, you know, life has been happening, mm-hmm. and you have to kind of pick up, change lives, change from one life into another life. So I think those are experiences that really informed what it must have been like for them and informed some of the early action in the book.
Mm-hmm. So when you first began the trilogy, did you already have the arc of the story worked out in your mind, mm-hmm. or did you explore it, you know, take it book by book and see where the adventure took you and your characters?
I did have the beginning and the end pretty much mapped out. The middle was sort of a little bit like that New Yorker cartoon of a scientific equation that says, you know, and then something miraculous happens here in the middle. But when I first started the book, I really envisioned a book in three movements. And I think even at first I thought one book in three parts. So, you know, present, past, return to the present. And as I hit about page 400 of the draft of the first, what is now Discovery of Witches, I was about halfway through what I wanted to accomplish in, you know, movement one, I thought, okay, well, you know, this will need its own special cart to carry it around with, or it's going to need to be three separate books. So that's really, it was always seen of as this, in sort of these three episodes or movements for all the obvious reasons, you know, of changing locale, temporality, cast of characters, everything like that.
Will you recommend this book or put it on your syllabus for your students? Is this required reading for students in history?
Interestingly enough, I've never assigned a book I've written in any class I ever taught. I always feel like they have me. Why would they need, you know, they can ask me and I'm there for them. I will say, however, that I have often taught Harry Potter in classes, and I've often taught The Name of the Rose by Umberto Eco. So it's not that I have an objection to assigning works of contemporary fiction in classes. It's just that I'm not sure if I could do it with my own book. They can go off and read that and then come to my office hours and ask me questions if they want to.
This must be fun office hours.
I'm very, very fond of my students. I'm a pretty lucky person to be able to talk about history, which I love to do, as anybody who reads Shadow will discover, or reads Discovery will discover. It's a pretty fun time.
Well, it's a great gift to be able to be a historian and a novelist and to bring the two together in such a wonderful way in the trilogy.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you for joining us
today.
Thank
you.